Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength and our salvation. May we ponder your mystery and your love, that you may have your way with us and make us anew to be your people. In Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. I'm sure I've told you stories before, but another one of my Aunt Charmy and Uncle George, one of the greatest things of my childhood was whenever we would go down to visit my aunt and uncle. I loved my aunt, I loved my uncle, but I especially loved the fact that they had had 9 kids. Because 9 kids meant that you could get away with almost anything. And the other great part of 9 kids is that you did hear your parents calling, but you simply pretended not to. And in the chaos, they sometimes just let it go. It was a great week whenever we got together. And the one year, we had our spring break from Washington Elementary School, and we went down over Holy Week. And the great part of being with my aunt and uncle on Holy Week was that we created as much chaos and stress as we could for the grown-ups, and nobody bothered to mention church at all. And the closest thing we came to holiness that week was that in the midst of our constant playing and running and everything else, the grown-ups put on the movie, The Greatest Story Ever Told. This was the good old days when you had commercials in your movies when they were on television. You know, The Greatest Story Ever Told was one of those epic Hollywood spectacles. Not spectaculars, it was a spectacle. They had a cast of thousands. It was filmed on location in Utah. Arizona, too. They got some of the biggest Hollywood stars of the day. You know, people who just fit the role, like John Wayne as the Centurion and Charlton Heston as John the Baptist. And I will add, the movie by itself was over 4 hours long. When you added commercials, they had to do it over 2 nights, and it went on forever. And any hope that the grown-ups had that we'd actually watch it, forget it. And in fact, I guess maybe they hoped we'd just behave better if Jesus was on television. So in any event, we pretty much ignored The Greatest Story Ever Told. We knew it was there, and we knew it would always be there. And so the second night, the movie had been on forever. My cousins and I were reenacting, I believe, the greatest battles of World War II, moving from one to another. And in the background, Jesus was saying holy things. They finally reached the point in the movie, towards the end. Jesus is on trial. He's condemned. And I guess somebody had had enough of us. And we got shushed. We got shushed good. And we had to come watch all of this. And so we see this story unfold. And one of my cousins, who will remain nameless since I want to still be on speaking terms, one of my cousins for the first time realized that crucifixion was a bad thing. And so it really bothered him to see Jesus walking with this cross. So he jumped off the couch and he shouted, "Come on, Jesus, fight back." And then he added, "If I was there, I'd take that cross and I'd start bashing people over the head with it." And he started saying, "You know, you could swing across real well." And we just all jumped off the couch at that point, enacting how if we were there, we would know what to do. And we'd fight off the Romans, we'd fight off the religious leaders, and we would have rescued Jesus, and it all would have been different. But no matter how much we shouted at the TV screen, Jesus kept carrying the cross and walking towards the hill called Golgotha, place of a skull. And there he was crucified. And you know, we were kids. And we really didn't get the story. And I'll add, sometimes as adults, we may be tempted not to get the story. You know, the way we reenacted our war, we weren't there, you know that, right? Too young. But we thought it was glorious. Good guys always won. And you'd always have a victory without suffering. And that's not the way of the cross. And for Jesus, the cross was not an accident. And it was not one choice among other choices. It was the only way for him to fulfill God's will. And on the cross, Jesus allowed himself to be crucified, to die for the very people who were killing him. In truth, Jesus dies for the unmerciful, for the unrighteous, the unworthy, the unrepentant, the unbelieving. He dies for us. And he dies to show that God's love is unlimited, unbounded, and unbroken, even by death. And that God's love is poured out for each and every one of us. And if you ever doubt if God's love is for you, I would ask you the simple question. Have you in your life ever been unworthy, unrighteous, unready, unbelieving, unrepentant? And that's pretty much the whole human race. Then also know that God's love is unlimited, unbounded, and unbroken for every one of us. My cousins and I had fantasized about saving Jesus. The truth is that Jesus dies to save us all. As we hear the history of the Passion today, I invite you to hear this as God's story for us, God's love, unbounded, unbroken, freely given. Thanks be to God. Amen. And let us hear together the history of the Passion.